Bullshit again. My name's Corey McGee. This is Jason Boissonneau. Tonight we are hanging out with our friend Lindsay Deschamps. And Lindsay, how are you doing tonight?
I'm doing pretty good. Thanks. Thanks a lot for having me, guys.
Yeah, we're pretty happy to have you down in our basement here. We like to refer to it as the Beer and Bullshit Studios.
No, the studio. Do we?
Is it a
yes,
studio?
Yes, sorry, yes and. Yes and. Battery
yes
prop.
And battery prop. Not no but.
No but.
But still. So no, we're very happy to have you here tonight and to talk with us and maybe enlighten us a little bit on some really cool initiatives that you've got going on or that you're participating with a little bit of a larger group as well, right? I rely on Jay to provide me with some background information on these kinds of things, and obviously he's pretty bad at giving me these explanations.
I give him essentially the background on everyone, and like, oh, you should ask these questions. Okay, today I didn't give him any questions asked. Today was nothing. But to be fair, we are doing this somewhat under duress because I know Sophie, my spouse, and other women have told me, if you guys do not have a girl on here soon, we're going to stop listening. Paula threatened to boycott and to literally have a Trump rally out front if we didn't have a woman soon.
Yeah, so, they said there was going to be a women's march outside our house if we didn't have more
yet.
Women on.
So not saying that's the only reason why we're doing it.
Thank God.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad to be your token lady, guys.
That's two now?
That's two.
Noella and Lindsay.
Two of 18. Oof. Is this number 18 or 19?
This is number 19, volume 19 of Beer and Bullshit. Can you believe that?
Well, I figured we would quit by now.
Yeah, I thought too. I thought we'd be done.
Pretty brutal.
Yeah. So, Lindsay, tell us a little bit more about what you've got going on. From what I understand, the title of the project, if you will, is Falcons for Fort Albany, and it's centered around hockey up on James Bay Coast, right?
Yeah, so basically, just like a bit of backstory, 3 years ago, I was coaching a girls' midget hockey team in town, mm-hmm. and we had a player from Attawapiskat move to Timmins to play for our team.
We called them dwarfs,
what?
Not midgets. Girl midget team, that's kind of...
These are the interruptions you can look forward to for the next 2 hours.
Now I've lost my train of thought.
Girls midget team. A girl had from Attawapiskat had come to play for girls midget team.
Yeah, so we decided what a great way to show her family what she's been up to. So we decided to plan a trip up to Attawapiskat with about 15 teenage girls, six adults, and we drove up the winter road 3 years ago. So we left from Timmins at 6 a.m., made it to Moosonee at about noon, had lunch in Moosonee, kept going, made it to Attawapiskat at about 6 or 7 o'clock at night.
So you guys drove up to Attawapiskat?
Yeah, we drove up the road. It took forever. So when we were there, we basically just put on free hockey schools for the kids. We rented the ice, we played games against their men's teams, their boys' teams. We had some downtime with the girls. We went out to the James Bay. We went snowmobiling. We went ice fishing. It was awesome. It was a really, really great experience for everyone. And so when we came back, we had gotten feedback, and Fort Albany heard that we had gone up. So they requested that we go up to Fort Albany the next year, because two of our players who are from Timmins, their band is Fort Albany.
Okay.
So we decided, all right, we'll do it again. 15 girls, six adults, made our way up the winter road. This time we took the train.
Okay.
Yeah. So last year, took the train in Cochrane, put the trucks on the train, took the train up to Moosonee, got the trucks out, and drove up to Fort Albany. So, both times that we went up, we got people. We had donated hockey equipment, donated food. By the second year, the Fort Albany year, we had probably tripled in donations. And it was fantastic. So we basically shut down their gym and it was packed full of free hockey equipment for the kids to get.
So just come pick up and...
Pick up. There was enough bags for kids. Like, there was enough hockey equipment for almost every kid to get a full set of hockey equipment. And really great quality stuff. People were giving away things that were barely used. We got donations as well, as far as North Bay. Source for Sports there has been awesome with us. They've been giving us a ton of stuff. Yeah.
So you guys have already forged these kind of partnerships with other communities and so on.
Exactly. Okay. So this year I decided not to coach at all because Fort Albany basically reached out and asked us if we would help them set up a hockey league. So they don't have a hockey league there because they don't have a rink. They basically move their rink around every winter to wherever they feel is best. Sometimes it's on the river, sometimes it's on a pond. This year it's just in someone's backyard.
Man.
Just someone like set Mystery it up Alaska. For them.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I don't think a lot of people are aware of that, right? Like, people don't realize just how isolated these communities are.
Right.
And you were telling us before the start of the podcast how this is really the only one that doesn't have an indoor hockey, like an indoor ice rink, right? Where kids can go and play hockey.
Yeah, because Attawapiskat have a rink, the Cache have a rink, Moosonee have a rink. Fort Albany, they're kind of the odd man out. So what happens is, well, and they're also kind of like, they're like, till the ice road goes in, they can't travel anywhere either to get to a rink. Or they're taking a boat to the Cache. They're like, there's no way of getting around till the ice road goes in as well. So they're at a disadvantage. So every year there's a huge Indigenous tournament here in Timmins, the Mishkegwik Cup.
Okay,
it's
yeah.
in February. Probably a lot of people know about it. It's when like Walmart gets completely cleaned out because they do their shopping while they're here too.
Of
it's
course,
just totally understandable. So every year they come to Mishkegwik Cup, but they've barely been on the ice. So we, like, our goal was to get them on the ice sooner, have gym time with them, and basically make sure so when they did come to Mishkegwik Cup, they had like a fighting chance to maybe make it a little further than they usually do.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
So how's the reception been in the community?
It's been fantastic. We started in August. We go up once a month. We've been flying up. And like I think the first time we went, we probably had about 40 kids in the gym all weekend.
Mm-hmm.
By the second time, it was 50. Now when we go, it's a jam-packed gym with 60, 70 kids for all of our gym sessions.
And you gotta imagine that like the options for hobbies up there are probably pretty limited, right? So when something like this starts to present itself, that people just glom onto it, right?
Absolutely. There is nothing to do up there. And man, I think that's one of the issues of living up there. There's like when we go, we get the gym, and the kids, like they show up 30 minutes early and we have to like usher them out because they don't want to leave.
They don't want to leave.
Yeah.
Man.
Mm-hmm.
See, it kind of makes you, you know, feel a little bit bad about how we didn't appreciate our hockey experience growing up. Well, I was thinking about when you were talking about bringing these girls up to the coast. I was like, where were these character developing experiences when we were midgets? All we had is like our parents getting drunk in a hotel room and us trying to sneak some beer. Like these were not developing us into like health, you know. Psychologically stable and emotionally healthy adults.
Yeah.
So no, it sounds like it's amazing what you guys are doing with these.
Yeah. Like, you know, and the first time we went up, we had a bit of pushback from some of our players because a lot of the parents were like, "I don't think I want you bringing my daughter all the way up there. It's not
feels like the Wild West.
It's kind the Wild of thing, West. Right? I mean, it's a long trip, and like it was a trip filled with accidents." Like once you get on the ice road, as soon as there's just to say a little bit of snow, it's treacherous.
Oh, of course.
So like the way back took us 17 hours to drive back from Attawapiskat that one time. Yeah, because we couldn't drive faster than 10 kilometers an hour down the ice road.
So draw for us a picture of what this ice road is, because I've never been on it. Have you been?
Nope.
No? Like that, I've always heard about the ice road, but is it like, is it literally a road with like ditches and you gone or what?
So
what
are basically, we looking at? So when you get to Moosonee, you turn left, and there's this really, it's probably as wide as three cars, and it's a sheet of ice. You could skate it. It's beautiful. It's clear. It's like they Zamboni it every day.
What?
Yeah. It's, and like, I guess they say like your tires are more likely. They just, they're fine. Like it's as soon as you get a bit of snow on it.
Okay.
But yeah, it's basically, it's really, really wide. You tend to have someone with a radio in the front just in case, because when transports go through, you stop, you pull over, just in case you don't want to meet a transport in a turn.
Okay.
And yeah, that's about it. And it's just, You just drive.
Is it straight?
It's straight. Quite straight. Oh, it's really shit. Straight.
Yeah. That sounds like it'd be pretty crazy. They got like those ice road trucker shows there. Yeah. They look pretty crazy. No, I think it's pretty amazing that you guys have been, I'm not sure where this all kind of came from. Where was the I guess you mentioned that you had a girl from Attawapiskat playing on the team, but who kind of came up with this idea that, like, we're going to, you know, go up there and organize? How did it get from that to organizing a league in Fort Albany, right?
Well, it started with, so my mom was always my manager for the team.
Okay.
And Dr. Judy Gillies from mm-hmm. Timmins, she's also a huge help. So Dr. Gillies, her husband is from Fort Albany. Okay. So that's where, Judy kind of set up with Monica's parents all the details. Monica's parents were amazing. They basically set everything up for us. And they even drove.
And Monica is the girl that was on
the girl from your team. Attawapiskat.
Oh, from Attawapiskat. Okay.
So she's, so they basically drove to Timmins, picked us up, drove us to Attawapiskat, and then drove us back to Timmins.
Man.
Yeah.
My question is, what, because like Corey was saying, the character development of like a type mm-hmm. of programming at Fork for kids seems pretty intense, and we didn't get anything like that. Did you see a difference in the girls afterwards? Did you see, like, was there comments from mm-hmm. them saying, wow, like, I never expected that, or this is, like, was eye-opening for some of them?
Oh, absolutely. When they came back, they even said, like, they learned more on our trips than they ever did in school. Attawapiskat was tough. I don't think they expected to see what they saw. The poverty there is to the extent that I think a lot of people have no idea.
Really?
Yeah, like, people don't have doors, they have blankets. People don't have windows, they're boarded up. It's quite, like, a lot of stray dogs. The people are fantastic. Mm-hmm. But really, it was really tough, I think, for the girls to see how fortunate they really are.
Mm-hmm.
And the kids who had come to the rink were just so happy to see us. Mm-hmm. The parents had even told us it was one of the first times that people went to to Attawapiskat just because. Not trying to sell them something, not try to
report on something exactly. or, like, you know, showcase to the world how poor it is up there. It's just a matter of going up there to kind of share an experience, right?
Exactly. And when we came back, that was our spin on everything, was how positive it was, how great the people were, mm-hmm. how much fun we had, how welcoming they were. And then when we did Fort Albany, we also got to sit down with the former chief, Ed Matatawabin, and he was a residential school survivor as well. So he sat the girls down and he talked to them about it. And I think it was life-changing. A lot of the girls had no idea. Mm-hmm. And coming from Ontario, like the French system, a lot of the girls, like La Sainte Catherine, they discovered, like, what that really means.
What that was about.
What that was about.
That lady wasn't that nice.
Yep.
And how, life. Like, and how, like, the schools still celebrate that.
Yeah.
So they actually, when they came back, the girls from the French board put a video together and presented it to the board.
Oh,
to
really?
Try to get them to stop doing La Sainte Catherine.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just it seems a little outdated.
Yeah. A little party to, you know, celebrate pretty well ethnic genocide. Well,
yeah.
Or
exactly.
systematic genocide.
Yeah, yeah that yeah. It just seems like, and I mean, you could progress from that without, you know, without saying that everybody who celebrated it back in the past is fucking stinking racist, right? Like, there's a way for us to all collectively kind of move past it, but I guess that's a larger issue. So I kind of want to get back a little bit on the Fort Albany thing, because mm-hmm. what you were saying is, like, they don't have the indoor ice surface, so you guys are going up there and trying to prepare them without access to an indoor ice surface or any way to run traditional hockey drills. I wouldn't know where to start. To start getting kids organized in a gym to get them ready to come play in a hockey tournament here at Timmins. So, like, what do you guys try to get them to do? What kind of exercises are you guys looking at?
Well, depending how many kids we get, usually if we get 50 plus kids, we'll do stations. Okay. So we'll have a station just for passing. We'll have a station for shooting, for puck handling or ball handling, I should say. And we feed them, so that gets a lot of kids out. And just a lot of organization, really. Yeah, we just kind of let them go. We have the older kids that help us out with the younger kids. And then when the older kids come in, we kick the younger kids out. And we do a few, like, more like, it's kind of like, we do treat it kind of like an ice surface.
Yeah,
we'll do Jills that, like, I might do on the ice, a little bit more toned down. And then the past two times we've gone up, we've just run three-on-three ball hockey tournaments.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. So they must love that, especially the tournaments, right? Like where things start to get organized and get the competitive spirit out in everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah. It must get pretty, pretty intense. But, so like, is there a goal, in mind as far as maybe looking to get them some kind of ice surface out there that they can access more frequently, a little easier, even though it might not be like an indoor facility or anything like that? Has that been mulling around?
I think it's been mulling around for 20 years.
And boy.
It just hasn't happened. There is no one really taking the initiative to do it.
Okay.
They actually have the structure in Fort Albany, just no one to put it up.
They have the structure in Fort Albany. Okay,
they actually have like walls and things.
Yeah. Like a module just, type of put together.
It's just sitting there, but now it's so rusted. It's rusty. It's been sitting there for years and years. And then they don't have someone to, like, they would have to hire a contracting company to travel up the coast and put it up
together. And then you have to have somebody to maintain and take care of the whole place, right?
Yeah.
It seems like quite the project. But I mean, maybe this is kind of like the initial kind of sparks for it, right? Yeah, exactly.
I think like that's kind of beyond what we're trying to do. If that happens, that would be fantastic. We're just looking more like we're just trying to develop the individual child and hoping to get kids that weren't going to play hockey before because maybe they couldn't get skates, they couldn't get equipment. Now, well, they don't have that excuse anymore. So we actually have one of our kids who is coming up to Mishkegwik. He's never played hockey, organized hockey before, and it's his first time. They were saying how, like, even everything about him has changed because he's just so excited to come to Timmins. And we had told them, like, so if you come to Timmins, like, we're looking, like, you have to do good in school. You need to attend school.
Yeah.
And this one kid has done, like, a total 360.
Complete turnaround.
Well, 360, really, you'd be right back same spot. So, clearly 180.
180.
Yeah.
He's done
way
it, well,
to be a dick about it.
He did a 360, and, like, just now he's...
He did a 360. Okay.
And now he's just...
He didn't come around... I always laugh. I'm sorry. I think it's funny. I always think, like, oh, you know, this kid was the worst kid ever. Did a complete 360 and back. I'm like, then when he did 360, right back to be a bad kid? Anyway, I'm being asked.
Totally changed 360.
Well, you know what? I could just see that. Like, in you know, 15, 20 years from now, whatever, like, one of these kids just being like, fuck this, you know, like, we need a fucking place here. And be one, like, once you've fostered that kind of community spirit, and all it takes is one kid to just kind of look at it and see it as an opportunity and be like, you know what, like, let's get this started, let's get ourselves a rink, you know.
And I think that's kind of what happens every winter, just to get a rink going there.
Yeah,
the first year we went was, so the 2 years ago when we went, it was on their pond, and it was minus 30 degrees. The pond was packed. We had shown up. We just brought our skates. And this was on our way to Attawapiskat. We did a pit stop in Fort Albany and played hockey against the kids. So we lasted for about an hour before we were freezing cold, got back in the cars. The kids were playing till, like, the sun goes down. They don't even see anything, and they keep playing. It's such a... And the same thing in Attawapiskat. We would see kids... First thing in the morning, they'd be out at an outdoor rink, and the same kids would still be there at 9 o'clock at night.
Man.
Yeah, all
See,
day.
Doesn't it remind you a little bit of, like I remember being a kid and playing hockey like that. Like, as early as I could get on the backyard rink, that's when I wanted to be there after school. And the latest I could get off, that's when I wanted to get off. And I feel like there's no kids...
Well, there's also...
I don't know that there is any kids around here doing that, so it's awesome to...
It's actually not the same. It's not the same, but it's also similar to some of the issues they're having. Availability of ice. Growing up, there was an outdoor rink at every school.
Yeah, you mentioned
every
that
school.
A lot. Yeah,
because I grew up across the street from Fort Mac. They had one there all the time. They had St. Gerard. We had two rinks there all the time for as long as I can remember. And now you go by any of those places, they don't have outdoor rinks. And I would go, like, I would get dropped off, and a few hours later, my dad would come by, pick me back up, and if I was ready, I was ready. If not, come back another hour. Like,
yeah, but I feel like it's got to be a little bit more than that. I feel like there's a lot more excuses for kids not to do that. Because, you know, you look at the kids who don't have all those excuses up on the coast, and they're figuring something out to get themselves a rink when there is absolutely none available. Like here, if you know, you used to have to walk down the street, now you got to walk three blocks to get to the rink. Like that to me seems like a bit of a piss poor excuse, mm-hmm. but I guess it contributes to it. If you could sit at home with your iPad or whatever the kids are playing on. Yeah,
but at your age, every kid had a Game Boy. Every kid had a Super Nintendo. They had stuff to play as well, but they still went out.
It's rare. It's rare that you see kids outside playing.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. But also, you know, like some places you're not allowed to slide anymore because whatever. I'm not going to say people are doing a hell of a lot less. That's 100%. There's no way around it. But I think there is I think there's less availability when it comes to like sports of rinks, of places to go play the stuff. Like, you know, how well are baseball fields maintained now? Some of these schools, like they're overgrown.
The
yeah, they're overgrown, and there's nothing to play. So like, you don't have people going out to play baseball anymore. So I think it's when you know municipal councils and stuff like that, or school boards are like looking at, all right, well we need to save money. Well, guess what? We're not maintaining that field. Like that's just let it grow in. The kids will figure it out. That's the first thing to go.
Well, there used to be more volunteer organizations, kind of like, you know, what you guys are doing. There used to be a lot more of this stuff, I feel like, community engagement, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's both inspiring and somewhat depressing to see that, like, you see somebody do it and everybody goes, oh my God, it's so amazing that people are still doing this kind of stuff, yet they're, you know, it's kind of depressing that everybody's got to be so surprised that this stuff's still going on, right? And people are still volunteering to help develop, you know, hockey leagues or maintain things like tennis courts or baseball fields. So I don't know. Like it's hard. It makes you feel pretty old though when you start talking about shit like that. So as far as like your involvement with all of this, I know, you know, we've known each other for a while, and you've always been involved in hockey ever since I had met you. You've been involved in some form or fashion in the local hockey scene, either playing or being, you know, later on being involved in coaching. So tell us a little bit about like your kind of background with hockey and how this all became a bit of if I may call it a love affair with hockey.
Yeah, sure. Well,
sorry, Dash.
I was probably 5 or 6 years old. I was a figure skater and living in Kapuskasing. And it was really expensive to be a figure skater because you had like private lessons and things like that. And my parents were big believers in like, you go all the way. Like if you're going to do something, you do it right and you don't quit. And so, but all of a sudden my mom was just like, wow, like these lessons are really expensive. We're going to put you in hockey. So,
which is not expensive at all.
Back then, you know, not knowing what she was getting herself into. So back in the day, so my sister and I both switched to hockey. So what's now Timbit Hockey, that's when we started. So it was Tyke 2 back then.
Okay. It's like ankle biters, same kind of thing?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So we kind of show up. We're the only two who had some solid strides because we had been figure skating for a while. That's how I became a defenseman. I was the only kid who could skate backwards on the ice. And yeah, so we started playing hockey. I loved it immediately. Just kind of kept moving up, playing boys' house league. That's all that was available back then. I think we were the only two girls in our age group that were playing back then.
That were playing hockey.
That were playing
in your hometown.
Yeah, in Kapuskasing. Okay. I think there was a few older girls, but they're like I could probably count on two hands how many girl players there were. Yeah. So this was in the early 90s.
Okay.
So by the time we were about 12 years old, we got enough girls together to start our own team, our own peewee team. And I was kind of mentioning to you guys earlier how parents had gotten together to sign a petition not letting us play in the boys' house league, the peewee boys' house league. So, and it was actually, I think they got 30 to 40 signatures. And the first game that was scheduled to play against the boys' peewee house league, the team refused to come out on the ice.
What?
I love that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so the coaches.
I got a funny, me and Jay got a funny story about refusing to come out on the ice there, but we might not talk about that. No. But that seems so absurd, right? But to think about that a team would refuse to come out on the ice, does it like harken back to like, you know,
like the monkey trials or something ridiculous.
Shit, like,
and like their parents yelling, like they were yelling at us. And so I guess the ref ended up getting off, telling the coach, listen, if you don't put your team on the ice, like, you are suspended for the rest of the year. Yeah. Get your team on the ice. We end up winning 1-0.
Oh, that hurts.
And so I think everything kind of calmed down after that. But that was pretty cool. And then when I turned, like, so that year I was probably already playing competitive boys as well. I started in Kiwi. And then from then on, I basically just played competitive boys till I left for university.
Okay. Yeah. So all throughout, like, your teens and high school. Eh?
Yeah.
Yeah. And we've played against each other.
Yeah. We played against each other a few times. Yeah, I don't know if you remember, you gave me a concussion 1 year.
Jesus Christ. Okay. Yes. Thanks. I thought that I was hoping that wouldn't come.
I want to bring it up. That's going to be so awkward.
But
I thought it was
going to
be the best.
Not, it wasn't intentional. It was just because I'm short, right? So whenever I would get hit, I would often get an elbow. Just because I went to your elbows.
Yeah. I don't know. I have never been at a loss for words on this podcast. I don't know what
to recall
say.
Right after that, one of your players came and decided, well, he has to stick up for you. Went after Corey, dropped the gloves. McGee drops the gloves. McGee, within half a second, rips that guy's helmet off. And I couldn't, it was comical. It was almost like a cartoon. Swings for this guy, and this guy ran away. And Corey was...
That's the kind of guys you had defending you, right?
Corey first didn't notice until he was almost falling over. Like, what the heck's going on? Like, where was that face? I swung at something. No one showed up. And the guy turned around and said, no, wait, you got to take your helmet off first. And Corey just pointed to the ground. You come here right now. The guy said, nope. Fight was over.
I didn't even know that happened, but I was semi-comatose on the bench. I guess so. It really, and it's funny, like, it wasn't a really hard hit. It was the way my head went into the boards.
Yeah, and it's the way it just kind of all, it was like a distance for, if anything, like, that was a boarding penalty.
Did high school Lindsay hate Corey at the time? Like, were you, like, really mad at him for a while?
No.
She had to sit out for a bit, so.
Well, actually, truthfully, I actually played that night.
Oh, shit.
But got hit again, and I was out for months.
Oh.
Yeah, it was not a smart move on
my
part.
We didn't know the stuff about concussions back then.
Yeah. I remember,
like,
you came out.
The doctor was like, don't take Advil and don't go to sleep. Yeah. I went home. I passed out. I was so exhausted. Yeah, I couldn't play for about a month, but I think it's probably my second hit.
Yeah, for the second hit.
I was always under the impression, like, I was always told, my parents would always tell me, you want to play there? You suck it up and you take it. And that's how I always was. So you hit me, I'm going to get back up and it's going
to
be okay.
It's like the same time as sex with Paula. Just suck it up and take it. And I said, okay, I'll take it.
Jesus Christ. You know this is going to be viewed by tens of people, right? Tens of people. No, that's a really interesting kind of topic of discussion, because we were talking about this a little bit before, and I thought it would make for good discussion, is to talk about, you know, boys and girls playing hockey, and the way it is now, like, I don't know, I guess depending on whose viewpoint you're looking at it from, do you think it's better now that there's a lot more girls playing hockey, so there's a lot more options available, a lot more, like, there's enough girls teams to have a girls league, right?
You know, Lindsay, think about your answer for a sec. Okay,
I'm gonna cut you off.
Think about your answer.
Beer bullshit thing.
Because I want more beer.
Okay, sorry.
And I will discuss the beer part. So think about your answer. So you have nice concise. Answer.
Concise. We're on a strict time frame here.
I can't beat that Paula comment, so I'll do my best.
All right. So tonight, we are drinking.
What are we drinking tonight, Jay? It's pretty good.
StoneHammer Brewing. Premium Session Lager from Guelph, Ontario. It's also, I think StoneHammer is also F&M Brewery. Not too sure why one says Stonehammer and the other one says F&M. But anyways, Stonehammer Brewery. A finely crafted light lager produced with 100% premium German Pilsner malt, producing an easy drinking lager with a light, refreshing malt taste. In other words, a light beer with flavor. It is 4.2%. 4% alcohol. I don't know why. Beer Advocate's giving me a different, some different stuff, but essentially still the same. The Beer Advocate score is giving. Oh, actually, I'll wait till what you guys say it is. What would you rate this on a 1 to 10, Mrs. Deschamps?
I'm not even a huge beer drinker, and I really liked this, so I'm going to give it an 8.
Oh, shit. Generous.
Because it's light. I enjoy light beer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not quite what I'm used to. I think I'm gonna have to give it like a 4.5. And I know Jay's gonna tell me that I have to rate it for what it is, right? But I have a hard time with that. I mean, it's all beer to me. So
it's all beer to you.
Yeah.
It's a light lager. Essentially, kind of like every light beer you have.
It does have flavor though.
It's more flavorful than all the other crappy light beers.
If zero is Coors Light, and
if zero, well, I would give this I would give it a 7, but I think like you're saying, it's, you have a hard time distinguishing. So I would give it 5.5.
I've often been told that if I like a beer drinkers won't like it.
There we go. So we are.
Yep. So if you're not
bona fide beer drinker,
if you're not a beer drinker, you will love this.
There you
but
go.
I was telling Corey.
Okay, so we're gonna put that quote in the description when we tag them.
There you go.
And we are definitely not okay because me and Jay have been kind of talking about how which beer company is gonna send us swag first.
Not a one.
It's probably gonna be Full Beard if we're like we really kind of get in there with him. He'll kind of hook us up, but if not. We're kind of talking about who's going to send us some swag. Well, it's definitely not going to be this beer company.
Yeah. And you know what? I if this was in the fridge, I'd grab it and I'd drink it. So I think maybe it should get a couple points for it.
True.
But it's just a light lager. I would like to try their other ones to see what...
they have other stuff?
Yeah, they have other beers. So they don't just have light lager. So I think... I did pick a light lager just in case people did not like beer.
Thank you.
So I figured I picked something that was easy drinking. So I grabbed it, but they do have other flavors, and I would like to try those to see, really compare them, really see what they're how they stack up against other companies, breweries.
Yeah, other beers we've had featured on the podcast. Well, yeah. All right, so where were we before we were so rudely interrupted by Jason with his beer talk? Actually, I love when he does the voice. It's fucking great.
It's great.
Great radio.
So smooth.
We were talking about about girls hockey and seeing if the development of it and the fact that and I don't know, like I guess maybe I'm a little bit out of touch with how hockey is today, especially minor hockey. Are there still girls playing a lot with boys, or has girls hockey developed to the point where it can be its own thing?
I know of one girl playing competitive bantam. I don't think there's any girls playing midget unless it's midget house league. It's developed to something that there's no longer the need to play boys hockey, mm-hmm. which is fantastic. So in the past few years, we've had lots of girls leave. So they'll, because there's some top hockey programs in Sudbury, in North Bay. We've even had girls go as far as Brantford in Ottawa. So we have girls, if they're not finding what they need at home, they're not even looking to boys hockey. They're looking to move away.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's almost like, you know what, we're done with this. Like, there's not, like you say, there's no need, there's no expressed desire to have... for girls to want to play with boys anymore.
And I mean, last year I think was the first year that the Girls Association had a team in every single age group. So from Timbits all the way up to senior. So senior is 21 plus. So they had a team in every single division, which is fantastic. It's the first time that's ever happened.
Man, that's... Yeah. That is pretty amazing. Mm-hmm. And I guess like what I was referring to, you mentioned that it was amazing that girls have these options now. Is it because you feel like girls in the past may have been turned off by the fact that they would have had to play boys hockey instead of, you know, having their own league, that they may have shied away from it or...
Maybe, yeah. That could be. I'm not sure because I love playing boys hockey, mm-hmm. but also my alternative was moving very, very far away, like Toronto. Mm-hmm. And even then, girls hockey wasn't the greatest. Mm-hmm. So
now, boys when you say hockey, not the greatest,
I mean it wasn't as developed as what it was, okay. as what it is today. Okay. Like for example, we have girls that are signing in grade 10 for universities.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, okay. That's the year to sign. Grade 9, grade 10, if you can get scouted by then, you're set to go. And that's like Ontario teams as well. So we have girls that are committing to Nipissing in grade 9 and grade 10. So that's how competitive it is. Whereas when I went to Western, I spoke to the coach before. He saw a bit of video from me playing. Uh-huh. He's just like, "Okay, come to the tryout. We'll put you up in athletes, like in our athletes floor for res." I showed up, I made the team, and I played for 5 years. Whereas now, like a walk-on is extremely rare. They'll have being tryouts, scouted. But you're being scouted.
And do you find there's an issue or still a difficulty with people in like Timmins or the North being? Like having the exposure that someone in a Toronto area would have. Because I know I had a good friend from St. Catharines. She played Division I at St. Lawrence University. She was great. But honestly, I played with you. I played with, you know, a senior sister play. I played with Mel Brunet. Any of these girls were as comparable or better. And this girl was Division I, and I played with other girls that she knew in intramural leagues in Windsor. And they played for Dartmouth, they played for whatever, all Division I. And the ones I knew here who played with the boys were just as good or better. So, like, mm-hmm. was it an exposure factor that they got being from Southern Ontario or?
Like, back in my day, yes, it's for sure exposure. Mm-hmm. So, I know, for example, there was a group of Sudbury girls. They had to do, like, a U.S. tour. So, they left with their parents. I think it was, like, 6 to 10 girls. And they traveled and went to various universities in the States to practice with them to be seen. Because they were also playing boys hockey. So, there's no way of getting scouted if you're playing boys hockey because scouts won't show up. Yeah. Well, obviously. Whereas now, I mean, we had a girl from our team last year make the Brock team as a walk-on, which was fantastic. But we would try to also hit up AA tournaments. So, girls hockey, there's no AAA. It ends at AA.
Okay.
So like a AA team is like a top team in the province. So we would go to AA tournaments just for girls to get exposure. And they would get exposure.
Like AA boys tournaments?
Or girls.
Girls tournaments.
Yeah. Okay. We'd go to AA girls tournaments. Okay. And we'd perform quite well. We were very strong last year. We were ranked 2nd in the province, midget A. So like a strong midget A team can compete with like a mid... like a top 10 to 20 midget AA team. So we would try to just, like, we would push them and we'd go to those tournaments to get exposure. And there's, like, known tournaments for scouts. So there's tournaments that you don't go to because it's a waste of time, and there's tournaments that you go to because you know you'll get exposure. It's very, very political now.
Man, so where, so like, where is this going now? Like, I guess on the boys' side, there was always like those two streams, right? Guys could go play junior hockey, or they could go. And I'm saying this because me and Jay are former hockey players. Our listeners might not know that. And I say former, I emphasize former. What we do now is more like glide around and maybe call for a pass from now and then, but
and just
you know,
yell at each other for not passing the puck to the other one.
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much. We just chirp each other even when we're on the same team. So what was I saying? Back in the day, there was like the two streams, right? Guys could go play junior hockey and make a run at the pros, or they could take the education side, and you know, there was still the possibility of making a run at the pros on that side as well. It seems like what you're describing to me in girls hockey, that there's what seems to be the goal is if a girl can kind of pursue her education with sport, is like, are there professional women's like hockey leagues? Are there?
It's actually starting. They're not paid yet, but there's actually AAA senior down south. So there's Toronto have a few teams, Calgary have teams. So they're trying to get it started, but really girls will play high levels of hockey to go to university and to play, to get that scholarship.
The
ultimate goal is to get the scholarship and go away. Or even like in my case, we turned down the scholarship and went to Western just because I was thinking, wow, like, do I want to travel 17 hours to see my family?
Probably not.
And like good friend, like Sabrina Sullivan, because she went to Chattanooga on a full scholarship for running. Mm-hmm. And that's what she said. She said it was just so stressful knowing that you're you have to be on your game running if you want to stay there. So there's stress because, like, if you're not running well, you're off the team, you can't afford your education, and you're coming back home.
Yeah.
So I was lucky that my parents paid for my school regardless, and I could go. I played varsity hockey, but it wasn't hanging over my head that if I had a terrible season, I could come back and try out the next year. Mm. I wasn't losing a scholarship. I wasn't losing everything I've built.
Yeah, I've never really considered that. I guess, like, especially scholarships, like athletic scholarships in the States are pretty elaborate and full rides and that. They're worth a lot of money, right? Like, just because. Yeah.
Well, I had a buddy who played Division I, and his second year busted his leg. And essentially, because he signed a full ride, he had a full ride. But the next year, like, they got him on team and he played, ended up playing Southern Professional afterwards, which I think it's defunct now, I think. Anyways, but they essentially wouldn't look at him. Like, the team disowned him because he was hurt and couldn't play. Yeah. It's like, sorry, we're not talking to you. Like, the players wouldn't talk to him.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah. It was pretty intense.
Like, when we went to Rochester for a hockey tournament, we'd go to the States once a year to go play. And one year was Rochester. So we went to RIT.
Mm-hmm.
And their girls team, they just got Division I. So, like, it was amazing to see. Like, and they basically told us if our girls get any lower than a 10 on a beep test, they can't play. And like a 10, that's pretty intense. Not bad,
huh? I haven't done a beep test in a really long time, but I'm pretty sure I could never do a 10.
Yeah.
You were able to. In high school, you could do it.
You think so?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know about that.
Oh, yeah. But it's still hard. It's still
enough. Oh, yeah. So he was saying at the moment they had three girls who couldn't get a 10, so they weren't playing. They could practice, but they can't suit up.
But they couldn't play.
No, until they got a 10.
See, that to me is, and again, it's probably because I definitely have not stayed involved in anything hockey related, but it's kind of reassuring to me, especially, like, I have a daughter now, and I feel like she'll have more opportunities, you know, growing up than a girl would have had when we were growing up. You know, a lot more opportunities to do different things. I don't know. I guess you're starting to blur the line between, like, what girl sports and guy sports were when we were growing up, right?
Yeah.
Girls did dance, did figure skating. Guys played hockey and baseball and masturbated.
And you know what? Some of us took it serious and, you know, took it into the senior leagues.
Jay got a full ride.
I didn't get paid much for it, but you know what? When you love what you do, you keep doing it, and you watch tape, you perfect your form, you don't stop. That's just some people.
That's what you call it?
Take it serious.
Game tape? Game tape.
No, of yourself. Of yourself. You gotta watch your form. Why? Am I the weird one here?
All right.
Yeah.
So on that note, Jay, we like to do something a little bit fun on here. Jay's prepared us a game. We usually play the Rotten Tomatoes game, but since we knew you were coming in, Jay prepared us a new game tonight. Something, I don't know, is it fresh or is it just a rehash from another podcast?
Oh, absolutely.
Podcast? Absolutely. We steal shit from other podcasts.
It's on Eller's podcast. It's also on Sporkle.com. Which is a trivia website I go to all the time when I kill time at my previous employment. It's not where I currently work because I am all business where I currently work. Sure. She'll say where. Anyways, the game is a TiVo trivia. So essentially and we've done it once on this show before, but Mr. McGee wasn't here. It was with the local transient, John Blanchet.
Oh, so it's rehashed from our podcast.
That as well. Oh. And Rick Lemieux, where we did cop films. They're mainly comedic films, but cop films because we had Rick Lemieux. So today we're going to have we're going to do sport films.
Okay.
So what it is I will describe a film which would appear in the TiVo or TV Guide description of that film, and the first one to say what film it is gets a point. So all you got to do, so just to, I would say, yell in your name. So it'd be Corey or Lindsay. Just yelling your name, and then so,
bell
okay,
for
go
this
for it.
Next time.
Got it.
Your bell is your name.
All right.
So you just say the name, and if you get it, you get it. If you're quick on it, but you know you're wrong, too bad. You're done. The other person gets it.
Do you watch a lot of movies?
Oh, some
well,
of these.
We'll see.
You'll
we'll
know
see.
Most of these. So I kept them to sports. I wanted to do a little hockey, but
please tell me Mighty Ducks is in there because like
that's what I was thinking too.
My kid watches Mighty Ducks 5 times a day.
One, two,
that's
Mighty
too
Ducks
easy.
Three.
Too easy. All right, so we are going to start with a skilled young hockey player prospect hoping to attract attention of professional scouts is pressured to show that he can fight if challenged during his stay in a Canadian minor hockey town.
Lindsay. Is it Goon?
No.
Oh, fuck, Corey.
Are you kidding?
Is it Youngblood?
Yes, it is. Youngblood.
I don't even know that fuck movie.
No, no, Youngblood.
Oh, my God. Oh.
1982.
Okay. I'm like feeling the need to stop this fucking podcast and right now and put it on. Rob Lowe,
1982. Patrick Swayze, Keanu Reeves. Oh, Keanu Reeves is a goalie. He just doesn't, he says like three words, but there's a scene in this film, which I think is the best scene ever. Patrick Swayze is the captain. This, you know, like he's going to go to
and
the
this
show.
Is hockey?
Oh, yes, hockey! Yeah, hockey. He's going to the show. Rob Lowe's the new fast kid from somewhere in Michigan, coming up to this hick town called Hamilton, and fighting the Hicks from Thunder Bay, the Thunder Bay Bombers, and Racky. That's who it is. Racky's the goon. Anyway, so Swayze's like doesn't like Rob Lowe, hates him. They initiate him by shaving his nuts for some reason.
Well, and that was a typical initiation back in the day,
exactly.
Wasn't it?
So, literally, they go mid-game. They're literally just skating around center ice circle, passing to each other, trying to, like, prove to each other that they're better than the other one for literally, like, 58 seconds, just going in a circle, passing. And it's like, it would never happen because you would get killed. And they literally just did a circle the entire time. It's the best hockey scene ever.
The plot arc in this movie is just something to witness. Oh. Like he gets kicked off the team
for not fighting.
Okay, not because he's not a great hockey player.
He actually quits.
Okay, he quits because he's embarrassed because he didn't fight.
Yeah,
and then he goes back home
to his farm.
Like for a montage scene of him learning to fight, and then he comes back and they just let him back on the team.
And this within the same playoff series against the same team.
This is so like 6 months there. Like.
Yeah. It's just he left for a weekend, fights his dad on an outdoor rink, and then his brother, who was a better hockey player but lost his eye, teaches him how to fight. And
I really want to watch this.
It is
guys.
Fantastic. Watch this.
Can we? Oh. I wanted to sidebar something though.
Okay.
Oh sure.
Hockey players, what's the worst initiation you've ever had that you can share?
I can share on the really? Podcast. We can share anything on this podcast. This is going up on YouTube. But I mean, like,
I was a mouth. I didn't really get much. No.
Initiation. You know what? I can't even think of anything off the top of my head. Like
rookie parties. No.
No.
Rookie parties. No.
No.
No. It's boring. It really is. Like, but
I like that you guys are like making eye contact. Like, no.
We're sworn to secrecy.
There was nothing. There was nothing.
Well, Randy Vermette touched me once, but that was just. We just did it on our own.
Okay, what do you think that this would make for an entertaining podcast? We've talked about this before. We would just invite a whole bunch of guys that we used to play hockey with and sit here and tell stories. And
those 12 stories. Guys would love it. Those 12, the other 12 guys who aren't on the show would love it. Because, I remember that one. Next to that, it'd be kind of boring.
I don't know. I think it'd be pretty good because I feel like there'd be some pretty funny stories.
Oh, there would probably be some
good
ones.
Mainly, you would have to have
one character who was years since we've been like 7 to 18 was the biggest shit disturber and like just really bad kid was Lee Tiffany. That kid has stories about him. It was ridiculous.
I remember him.
Oh.
Yeah.
He was nuts. Anyways, back to our game. So.
So that was Youngblood.
Yeah, that was Youngblood. Anyways.
That was close though, Goon. You said fighting. No, you said fighting.
That's what
in
I thought
town.
Initially as well, yeah. Because when he said Canadian town, and I'm pretty sure like fighting wasn't just central to Youngblood. Like,
Before I go to the next one, you guys should really check out. There's a Vice News expose documentary about the LHNH. the Quebec like Goon League, which the Goon is based on. There's a huge Vice City thing, and then just start watching, not Vice City, Vice News. Then start checking out all the YouTube brawls of this league. It is insane. It's actually kind of scary. Like, my heart starts like racing because I'm like, oh my God, someone has to stop these people. Someone's going to get hurt. Anyways, yeah. No, check it out. It's actually pretty badass.
It's what the Vegas team should be doing.
Yeah.
That's what they should do in Vegas.
Just complete. Yeah, it'd be perfect. All right. So, next one. A boy lands a job with the Chicago Cubs after an arm injury leaves him with a major league Corey. Pitching talent. Yeah.
Rookie of the year.
Rookie of the year, 1993.
Yeah. Do you remember that one?
That's an old one.
It's like, the guy from American Pie that was in it, right?
I know, I watched it. I just don't remember what it's about.
Yeah, he breaks his arm and then suddenly he's like throwing the hardest fastball ever.
Yes.
Yeah, broken like this.
Yeah, yeah. And then he breaks it. He breaks it right before the big game. So yeah, he can't throw. Or he falls. He
falls and puts it back into place. Oh, I can throw normal now. Oh, no. Yeah. So stupid. But I think in over to get it, is that Rookie of the Year? Because there's the other one that was... the coach, where he becomes the manager. It was like the same type of thing. It was like happened like the year after. There was Rookie of the Year. Then it was the movie where he becomes the coach of the Twins and teaches them how to play. Like they're playing literally like stickball.
Was
like
that the rules. Sequel?
No, it wasn't a sequel. But it was like almost the exact same thing. But I
Angels in the Outfield.
Not Angels.
with Charlie Sheen there? Charlie Sheen shows up with his glasses and he pitches. And
that's Major League. Yeah, Major League. Okay.
Okay, that's what I'm going to get rid of. Anyways, a deep bond develops between a cantankerous trainer and a female boxer. Reluctantly... Yeah,
Million Dollar Baby?
Yes, I screwed up.
Oh,
it's a great movie. Great movie. Academy Award winner right there.
You know what? Nice. Is that the one where she hits her head on the... No?
I don't know.
She hits her head at one point? Like,
I think she gets knocked out or whatever.
Yeah, she gets... Yeah.
She's dying. They should pull the cord. Or what's her name again?
Yeah, yeah. Hillary Swank.
Hillary Swank.
Yeah. There you go.
So it's not Karate Kid Part 4?
Three ninjas.
Hillary Swank was Karate Kid in Karate Kid Part 4.
Bullshit. Really?
100%.
I did not know that.
100%. If you can try to prove me wrong here, look it up. I know my Hillary Swank movies.
The next Karate Kid. Hillary Swank. Yeah, he's right. Man.
Jesus Christ.
Okay.
Anyways.
Young Hillary Swank.
The next one. A heavyweight champ gives a Philadelphia club fighter a title shot. I didn't give names because it was going to be too easy if I gave the names.
Say that again. Yeah, it's not.
No, heavyweight champ gives a Philadelphia club fighter a title shot.
Holy shit.
Yes, Lindsay Rocky. Philadelphia club
fighter. There, Lindsay Rocky, she said it.
What?
1976.
See, and I've never seen the Rocky movies. I just knew Philadelphia.
Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, it was never really interesting.
I knew the Philadelphia. You've never seen any of the Rocky movies?
Oh, they are fantastic.
When
I've had an argument about this with my one friend that number 2 is the best. Number 4 is the best.
With Drago?
Yeah.
Yeah,
it is. That's by far the best. Number one is the second best, and then I'll go number 2.
Anytime you beat the Russians, it's the best of anything.
The Mr. T was part 3. Mr. T
was good. No, that was Clubber Lang.
Yeah, he says Clubber. Yeah, he thinks number 3 is the best. I don't think so. Number 4 is the best. Drago. Wow. Such a good.
Such a good villain.
I'm going to go home and have all these movies to watch.
I can't believe I haven't watched a Rocky movie.
Okay, I can't believe I didn't guess that. Like, it's just...
And like that took a while.
Apollo
Creed gives him a title shot.
Wow.
And it's one of the best ones because, and spoiler alert, but I'm sorry, it's from 1976. You should have figured it out by now. He doesn't win. Like, the good guy doesn't win the championship. He loses. It's one of the few. It's that and Cool Runnings are essentially the only two.
Cool.
And Part 2 comes back and wins it. But
Cool Runnings would have been like just unbelievable, though.
Yeah,
and it's supposed to be based on a true story, right? So...
You can't just make
the Jamaican bobsled team win the gold medal. Like, wait a minute. True story.
All right, next one. A Virginia high school hires a black football coach after undergoing integration.
Lindsay, fuck off.
Remember the Titans? That was a great movie.
I was going to say, We Are the Titans. It's fucking We Are Marshall and Remember the Titans. Jesus, I'm getting my ass kicked. I'm so used to being beat at these games, though. Like, our guests,
I'm surprised. This is not like my forte here.
All right,
like, it's going all right.
All right,
I don't want to play in a game where it is your forte.
A high school baseball coach makes it to the major leagues as a middle-aged relief pitcher.
Is this with Kevin Costner?
No, it is not.
Fuck. Okay, a high school baseball coach
makes it to the major league as a middle-aged relief pitcher.
Middle-aged.
So it's not...
Who's in this movie?
It's not For the Love of the Game.
Who's in the movie?
Yeah.
All right, give us another hint.
Starring... let me just open it up. I know who it is, but I just want to make sure. I want to get the other people in it. Starring Dennis Quaid and Rachel Griffiths.
Oh, fuck.
Like Field of Dreams?
It's a Disney movie.
yes.
Oh, dear Lord.
I know this one is going to...
From the year 2000. No one's getting this point. I might have to actually bring one that I deleted as a tiebreaker just in case.
Are we tied?
No, not yet.
Okay, give us another hint.
Anyways, it's called The Rookie, so you're not getting it. All right.
I see what they did there. He's a middle-aged man.
Came back at the age of 41.
He's a rookie. It's kind of weird.
Based on a true story.
Really?
Yes.
It's just like the hamburger.
Okay.
All right.
I need to make a comeback here.
Yes, you
because
do.
I'm getting my ass kicked.
All right. The beer drinking manager of a peewee team bribes a girl pitcher to lead them to lose. To lead his losers. I don't know why this my little description screwed it up.
Oh, Corey.
Go ahead.
Bad News Bears.
1976 Bad News Bears.
Walter Matthau. Grumpy old man. All right. So,
we are tied.
I feel you did so good with everything pre-2000. And I'm like, I don't know. The Sandlot?
I've started wearing a hat on these podcasts because my hairline showed too much.
All right. So this is the tiebreaker, guys.
All right.
Tiebreaker. A failing ice hockey team finds success.
Mighty Ducks.
Using constant fighting and violence during games.
Corey. Slapshot. Yes!
1977.
Oh. I just tried. Yeah, that's why.
You know what? When he said a failing hockey team, that was my first instinct. And I was like, fuck, she got it.
there has to be Mighty Duck in here somewhere.
First of all, Mighty Ducks, it was not a failing team yet. He got just brought in to coach
a failing team.
Well, they weren't. I don't think they were in a team yet.
No, they were 0-5. She says it. Trust me, I watch this movie five times a day. It's
but the best part of Mighty Ducks, I always got to say, is he's coaching his team because he got charged for a DUI, and that's his punishment for a DUI is to coach a peewee team, which I think is hilarious.
We've had this conversation before. He said that Gordon Bombay had the best movie lawyer of all time.
Absolutely.
That got him off. But you know what's crazy? That I don't know that that's necessarily true. Gordon Bombay was representing himself.
Yeah, I know.
He is the best movie lawyer. So like, but what's crazy?
His boss cuts the deal to judge.
Yeah, it's his boss that cuts the deal. And what's crazy is the initial scene when they're in the courtroom is Gordon Bombay against his rival. I forget what is Frank or something like that. And then he basically gets his client off when the guy was actually guilty, and he's supposed to be this big hotshot lawyer. And then the next scene is like he's a completely disgraced drunk driving fool who's sitting there in front of the judge, and his rival lawyer is sitting there all smug like, we got you now. Next thing you know, he's fucking off coaching a peewee hockey team for his punishment for driving drunk and potentially injuring somebody.
and by far the worst hockey ever. As a kid I was always like, wow, these guys are really good. And then you watch it as an adult, you're like, oh,
it takes like 28 seconds to get from one end to the other.
The passes are just so slow.
And do you know what I noticed is they address a really big plot hole at the very beginning, because it was a tie game and he had a penalty shot, right?
Yeah,
right. So when he misses and hits the post as a little kid, and the goalie takes off celebrating like they just won the fucking game. Like, you'd think, okay, this was a shootout, and he, you know, he missed.
Yeah, it was a penalty shot.
It was a penalty shot. And then later on in the movie, he goes, "Yeah, we missed it by a quarter inch, and then we lost in overtime."
Then we lost overtime after, yeah. And I always thought that, too. Like, well, the rest of the team fucked up, too. No one else scored anything. But the best of that, though, is when he walks into the rink and sees all the banners, and there's the one, like, yellow banner between saying finalists, and he's like, he's still upset. That was a peewee. He was 12 years old. He is now 45, and he's still, like, crying about, oh, I can't believe I lost. This guy, we didn't find out, went to go play pro and got his knee taken up by someone. So how does he still care about what happened in Pee Wee hockey?
Yeah, he went to play pro. He was friends with Mike Medano. No big deal. Like,
well, this guy was the best Pee Wee hockey player I've ever met. He actually says that, actually. Mike Medano talks about him being a great hockey.
The best Pee Wee. Because it really mattered back then.
Exactly.
In Pee Wee hockey, if you could be the best Pee Wee hockey player, you're making it.
There's a lot of ridiculousness that goes on in movies when they talk about hockey. And it just goes to show that all these movies are made in the States. And they have no idea. No idea what hockey, like, I guess, hockey culture. Culture is really like, and the only one that really embodies it pretty good, I thought, and they did it really well for their time, especially, was Slapshot.
Yeah.
Like the profanity and the I don't want to get too Trump-esque here, but the locker room talk is perfect. Like, yeah.
But I gotta say, Letterkenny, the junior hockey players, they speak 100% like a junior hockey player speaks. Like, that is bang on.
I've never been a junior hockey player,
just
Jay.
So fast. You've got to, like, rewatch it a few times because they're spitting it out, and you're like, what did he just say? I know it's funny. I'm going to laugh.
I'm laughing just because I know it's going
to
be funny.
Yeah. Just because what he's saying really relates to me in my life.
Oh, man.
I know that guy.
Yeah, I've met a few of those Letterkenny guys. Oh, man. No, they do a really good job on that show. That show in general is pretty fucking hilarious.
Solid.
I still haven't seen. Well, they've started season 3, right? Was it supposed to play right after the Super Bowl?
Season 2.
Season 2, was that, or was it right after the Super Bowl?
Yeah, first episode of season 3 was supposed to be available. I don't know. I might be speaking out of my ass here, but that was right after the Super Bowl. Which, by the way, did everybody here watch this? Watch the Super Bowl?
When was that?
No.
What is this Super Bowl you're speaking of? Did you watch the Super Bowl?
I did not.
You didn't
even watch?
No,
it.
I just. I really don't care for football.
No?
Not at all. Right. And it's even like the halftime, like, I'm just like, I'll find out about it later. I'll watch the halftime show later.
No, that's okay.
So,
don't worry about it. I like kick the bar or the mic at least once a podcast. So, but the Super Bowl, like, I also don't really, I like football, but I don't follow it. The Super Bowl was the only game I watched this year, but it was fucking incredible to watch. Like, that comeback was unreal.
It is
the greatest, one of the best things I've ever seen.
Myself and, like, probably most people said, like, oh, when the Falcons got the touchdown to make it 28-3, I was like, all right, this game's over. Like, 2 quarters left. Game's over.
Let's go home.
No problem. Go home.
Well, there was something like on Facebook. It was like, okay, to win this game, I need 2 touchdowns. 3 interceptions.
Yeah. And it just, I'm sitting there, I'm like, oh, well, they got another touchdown. And it's another one. Well, math, you know, they can do it. All right, they got another one. All right, this is going to happen now. Like, especially that first half where, you know, they miss a field goal, getting picked, getting sacked, nonstop. And it was like, Atlanta couldn't do anything wrong.
Yeah,
they were killing. And then it was like, what the fuck's happening? And then it just.
2 2-point conversions.
Yeah, just fell apart. Completely fell apart.
It was crazy. Yeah, that was that happened this week, folks. Tom Brady became the greatest quarterback of all time. It was insane. Mm-hmm. Did you see that? What Jeannie Bouchard there?
Yeah,
did?
Yeah.
Fuck, I'm upset. I didn't put that out there.
JJ's bummed that he didn't do that. You got to play the odds sometimes, my friend.
Well, people are saying like she should, like the guy should kind of bow out and say like, listen, I know it was a joke. We don't have to do this awkward date.
Well, she said
he's probably working out now, doing push-ups every night.
Gonna get a good swell on.
He's like, I'm getting in there. I am not at, like, they're gonna have to kick me out
because she said like, oh, I'll do it, but you have to still plan a date and make it fun.
Yeah,
so
you heard that.
That's pretty fun. Yeah,
you heard that on was it TSN?
Like, I read it. I think I read it on TSN. Yeah,
Yeah, and she was basically saying, like, I'll fly him out.
Yeah.
Like, I'll pay for his flight, but he's got to pay for the rest of the date.
And plan it and all that. But that's for, man, badass. You know what? Just try it. Hey, you, if your batting percentage is going to be 0.001, hey, you still got a chance to hit something.
Still got
just go for it. That's what I'm going to teach my son.
I don't know what he's talking about
right
now.
Your batting percentage might be not, like, super low. Just keep trying. Just throw it out there. See what happens.
Wear him down.
He's just got to be a charmer. That's it. He's got a couple good lines. Yeah. And, you know, I don't know. I don't understand women.
Was it, and what isn't it his, like, Twitter handle, like, something stupid?
No, I don't know. I don't know what it was.
I forget what it is.
It's going to be
stupid. People are like, ooh, like, if that's his Twitter handle. Oh,
he's probably super douche.
He's going to show a big grease bag. Oh, man.
So right now we are missing, currently it is Tuesday night, we are missing the Ted Cruz and Bernie Sanders Obamacare debate right now. It's on CNN. We kind
of have to talk politics tonight. I've had
we don't have
so
to.
Much.
No.
I know I'm gonna want to. I'm definitely gonna want to talk politics. It's just, man, I feel like we've been so lighthearted tonight talking about hockey stories and talking about feel good stuff that we're. But you know what? I said that on this podcast when we were talking about with Jill. About the Bernie and Ted Cruz thing, that I thought that would have been a way more constructive conversation to have, having those two guys being the nominees. I mean,
yeah, the conservative guy against the super socialist.
Like the guy who's like, I guess you could call him a principled conservative, except he did shill for fucking Trump at the end.
Yeah.
And he was like, fucking feeling calls. You could just see how painful it was for him. But he, like, a principled conservative against a principled socialist and just basically actually debating the ideas. Then people can sit there and like, okay, you know what? Maybe these guys are kind of on the extremes of their ideas, but when you kind of get them together, they can at least make some sense of it all. As long, I don't know. I'm going to watch it tomorrow, I guess.
Yeah,
and you know, hopefully that'll be a constructive conversation.
Well, and they had their, was it like a sit-in? What was the...
That's stop the education appointment?
Yeah, for the education one. And she still got it by tiebreaker.
Tiebreaker by Mike Pence. By the president of Congress. That what it is, right?
Yeah, the VP.
They said it was the first time ever that had to happen.
VP is a congressional president.
Yeah. Well,
he's a president of Congress.
And that's the first time it's ever happened?
First time for it's
that,
ever happened. Yeah.
It's not the first time that it's been a tiebreaker. The other tiebreaker was a tax, some tax cut during like, the Bush eras with Cheney had to be the tiebreaker, but the first time that an appointment has ever been broken by a tiebreaker.
Oh, man.
So it just kind of show.
It's going to be a mess. Rough.
But, hey, 2 years, Democrats have 2 years to get their shit in order to win congressional elections, and then if they control the House and the Senate, they have a chance.
Is there any part of you that just wants to, like, sit back and watch the world burn?
That's all we can do, really.
Libertarians?
Yeah, I guess so.
Pretty.
No, it's, I don't know. It's kind of depressing.
I always said that Corey was all about small government, and I was like, you're ridiculous, you're nuts. And I was like, you know what, small government might be the way to go, because if it was small government, government wouldn't be able to do all this crazy shit they're doing right now. Like,
see, now he understands. He understands what I was talking about all this time. You may like the guy today, but you might not like the guy tomorrow. And apparently a lot of people don't like the guy tomorrow. No, there's a lot of crazy shit that's gone on. I mean, I don't even think we talked about like the whole women's march and everything. We only talked about the potential women's march outside of my house because apparently this is a misogynistic podcast where we don't have properly represented women's voices.
Well, when I told you, I was like, you should just have a panel of women and we could just hash it all out. We could talk about all these great things and give a women's perspective.
I think we should invite a panel of women to tell us how we should do our podcast. How we should structure it. And everything.
Yeah, I get that every time that Paul listens to one and says, oh, you guys didn't
You know
do
what
this
you
right.
guys should do? I love that comment. You know, but the thing is, we don't get. Honestly, we probably don't get that from women. We get that more from John Belanger.
Oh, fuck!
You know what you guys should do? You guys should do this, John. Start your own podcast. Yeah. Fuck.
But honestly, like if I will tell people if they have an idea, fucking tell me. Send me the idea. I will try it. I'll do whatever. It's not.
He will do his best to ignore it.
Yeah. If somebody wants to do their own podcast about whatever subject, like Lindsay Leonard wants to do the hockey podcast, or sorry, Lindsay Deschamps. I still can't get used to that yet.
It's okay. It's brand new.
Brand new. I know.
I still this can't week. Get used to it. Yeah.
I got it right.
Did you work on the signature yet?
Yeah, and it's terrible. Oh. Yeah, it's so long. And I'm always like, oh, I forgot a letter.
It is kind of terrible that women have to do that, though.
Yeah, I know.
They have to get used to signing their name differently.
I can see a Corey Bergeron.
Fuck.
What? Jay What's Clark? So bad with it?
No, I'm not saying
I would totally go Jay Clark. It'd be so much less writing for me.
Was it the presidential, the elections? I think I messaged that in when you guys did your live, and I was like, yeah, Jay Clark has
Were
a nice...
Were you following that night?
Yeah, I was.
Oh, man. What was your username? I didn't... You know what? That was a lot of fun. We should do another like live one.
Yeah.
But, and we had talked, like we had John Kay and Chris Sozino from Working Class on last week, and we were talking about doing a live one during their Heart of Gold Fest, like when they have like the bands and stuff in town. So I don't know. I think we're going to shape up and have good. A couple other live editions. That was fun. I had a good time chatting with people.
I think what happens to you, like it takes so long. You don't know anything till like when did they declare Trump?
Oh, yeah. They were declaring, but we literally left before it was over because we were just so...
We had to, and people wouldn't let us stop.
They're like, no, keep going.
Just keep going. No, you have to keep talking.
Because I listened to your podcast for quite a while, and then I went, I was like, okay, Hillary's got this. I'm going to bed. And I woke up the next morning, and I couldn't believe it. I was shocked. I was shocked that there was so many stupid Americans to vote for him. I couldn't believe it.
I think a lot of people didn't like her.
But also, was it just strategic? I really think that.
Well, most Americans voted for her.
Yeah, most. Yes. Yeah.
Most Americans who voted
sorry,
for her.
Well, yeah. Unless all these millions of illegals and millions of dead people.
Yes.
Anyways, the thing, I really think that he had a strategic game, and he went after winnable states. And took them, and he didn't need the popular vote. Yeah, sure, take all of California and New York and get, right there, how many millions of people. Mm-hmm. Yeah, go for it. We'll work on everyone else and just win these small states and just win, just beat them strategically. And it's kind of the way to do it. And look at the, provincial elections, liberals, essentially focus on one area, a GTA, Golden Horseshoe, and just go after these people.
Is that what it's called? The Golden Horseshoe?
The horseshoe, yeah.
All the way to Toronto, Niagara.
That's a weird sex move.
Yes.
The Golden Horseshoe. Sure.
But yeah, no, focus on that. And really,
the liberals, I don't think, would stand a chance next election. That would really surprise me.
I'll tell you right now, though, watch what happens in the next year and a half. You're going to see...
Our hydro bills are going to go way down.
Are going to go way down.
Yeah, that's the same.
Look what we're doing.
Liberal for that.
Look what we're doing. Yeah. We just brought them down. And everyone's like, you know what? Okay. And just because people forget so quickly about stuff.
That's true.
Yeah. They forget about
and
everything.
And teachers will be back up for negotiation. Yeah. She's going to do something awesome for negotiation. So we're going to be like, sweet, we've got to vote liberal.
Meanwhile, in the last four or how many years with the liberals have there been strikes with teachers nonstop? Because essentially they won't play ball. The government won't play ball, but now it's like, no, we'll play ball this time just for the election. Because then all the teachers.
But this is play ball right away. Last, when she wanted that vote, she, our last, there was nothing. Like, we literally showed up, they gave us pretty much everything we wanted and more, and then we walked away.
Yeah, that's insane. Like, I don't know. I feel like that just goes to show the arguments we've been having about, principled stance in politics rather than pragmatic, having a pragmatic stance. Like, I feel like the more you start developing this sense of principle in people that... people will willingly vote against their short-term self-interest by way of principle, I think we're going to be better off as a society. Like, and even if that principle happens to be, for larger government and more spending on, in healthcare and on anti-poverty initiatives, things like that, I think that as long as you're voting, if you just vote for... what you think is going to bring you the best benefit, you're missing the point of all of this. Like we need to look at politics and say, okay, I'm going to vote for the party that best represents my values. And if you're, I guess maybe it's just a sign of shitty people out there.
But no one does that.
Their values is just like, whatever, government's going to give me more money.
But
like,
think about rural and northern communities. Okay. You want to vote for a conservative value base. Small government, free enterprise, capitalism. All right, let's go with that. You see rural communities and northern communities being able to afford or being able to attract a hospital to Timmins, Ontario, to run a private hospital? Fuck no. There's no money to be made. So the idea that, oh yeah, it's like I'm a strict conservative in Timmins, Ontario. All right, well, pay for fucking healthcare.
No.
Pay for whatever.
That's not what I'm referring to. What I'm saying is that...
That's what I'm referring to.
Yes, but... yes and? Whoa. No, but still... what I'm more referring to is like vote for the kind of society that you want to live in.
But what I'm saying, if you want society that is larger government for whatever reasons and how they do it, why it seems like people don't do that in areas that it's like you're saying, it's self-interest stuff. They're like, oh, I'll go this way. I'm whatever. They don't think about kind of a, I don't know. I agree with you. I'm actually agreeing with you. I'll put it this way.
The conservative candidate first. Or provincial. I forget his name.
Patrick Brown.
Yeah, and he's facing, like, if you go on his Facebook, you check him out, conservatives are saying, we don't want this guy. He's liberal.
He's trying to be progressive.
He's too progressive. We don't even want him. So now they're like, how are we going to beat Wynn now? Because we don't even want this guy.
Yeah. We are not offering any palpable change. Nope. That's all. I don't know. Fucking politics is depressing these days. And this is like where this whole fucking podcast idea started off on, is that we would sit here and like talk about politics. And
we literally walk away from it sometimes. We're like, oh, we can't talk about this. We've not talked about Trump stuff because like, oh my God, it's so depressing.
Yeah, it's
but
depressing.
Also, it's not just that it's depressing, is that it's everywhere in the news. Like, you know, we want to talk about Trump talking about how the media is not covering terror attacks. It's like, that's the only
and
fucking
then he
thing
put
they
out
cover.
The list. He put out the list,
and every one of them
they
that they
misspelled
covered.
Attacker. Attacker.
Fuck. Taker.
Yeah.
But it's like the shit's all covered. So like, it's just like, oh, this is so depressing. And everyone's talking about it. So it's like, why bother? He's asking if you want another one.
No? Oh no, I'm good. Thanks.
You're
good? Yeah.
Why not? But no, it's.
Well, there was a I think it was the Washington Post. They had an article saying, like, Trump supporters couldn't be happier because he's doing everything he said he would do. Mm-hmm. So they're pumped.
Unlike most politicians.
Exactly.
I didn't say that into the mic, by the way.
I'm sure it picked up anyways. No, but it's, he's doing what he's saying, but like, I tell you right now, I'll get into this part because it seems like we're slowing down. It's him talking about... him dismissing the entire judicial branch now, which is it's crazy. And like, I know people who these super socialist progressive lefties are going, you know, go on in this big tirade about, you know, fascism, blah blah blah, but the idea that a president does say, all right, this judge is a so-called judge, he's useless, if anything happens it's the court's fault, blah blah blah, well, the courts there is a check and balance. Like, there's three levels of government because for check and balances in the states, and the fact that you dismiss one and you're trying to turn the populace on that part of the government, that's nuts. And that is actually super fucking scary. That is literally like, that's literally, you know, the Nazis literally just start cutting down and saying, no, that's retarded.
No,
talking with that. We are
the alt-right.
Alt-right. Well, just pretty fucking close.
No, that's the first problem right there.
Oh, man. It really does feel like kind of the world's going to shit. And what's brutal is, like, the worse one side gets, the worse the other side gets, too.
Yeah.
Like, did you see they had a conservative, the gay guy, his name? Milo Yiannopoulos.
Oh, God.
He was going to speak. Yeah, I find him annoying as fuck.
He's annoying as shit.
Did you see what they did at fucking Berkeley? Start burning shit down, fucking throwing rocks at cops and shit. Like, that's not, like, don't tell me that shutting people's opinions that you disagree with down with violence is.
So the difficult part, though, is do you allow the, I'm trying to think of the word, but the exploitation, not exploitation, but the increase and the ability to spread hate speech. Do you allow that to happen? Because let's be honest, this guy just spreads hate speech. That's all he does.
Well, no.
Okay. There's a good portion. Hey, no, go check his online social media.
I've listened to a lot.
There's a lot of shit he just pushes.
Okay.
Horrible.
Wasn't he banned from Twitter?
Yeah, he was the guy banned from Twitter.
Because he pushes hate speech, a lot of hate speech. Oh, he might have other stuff that's okay, but because he has, let's say, 70% okay and 30% hate speech, he sells a shit too much hate speech.
What I'm saying is that if we're going to play by the rules of hate speech, we need to define what hate speech is. And hate speech is a crime. Okay.
Yes.
So if this guy is pushing hate speech, should be in jail.
Well, we should.
Right?
Yeah.
So why is he not in jail? Why has he not been charged with a crime? Well, why is he like?
But it should. What someone should do.
Okay.
But no one wants to do it.
Then let that be the barometer. Like, right? We were talking about the whole fucking Holocaust denial shit. That's a crime. That's hate speech. That's I don't know. It's a crime somewhere. Is it a crime here?
It is.
If we deny the Holocaust in Canada, it's a crime.
Because one teacher
in Germany, it is.
I know the teacher lost his job in Manitoba at one point. He was all crazy about it, but it should be. And I don't care. It should be.
Okay, so fair enough. If it should be, all right. But again, we have the rule of law. We can't just have fucking places take the law into their own hands. So if it wasn't against the law here in Timmins to say that the fucking Holocaust didn't happen, say it till you're fucking blue in the face, I'm gonna fucking shout you down for it. You're like, call it what it is, hate speech. I'm gonna petition the government to make laws against it, but you're not going to jail until there is a law against it.
And I'm not arguing that. I didn't argue any of that.
So what I'm saying is that, like, to arbitrarily say, you know what, this guy, we're going to punish somebody even though they're not doing something that is illegal, instead of working towards making it illegal, is you're subverting the rule of law.
But I think there's such a fine line between hate speech and free speech that it's, where do you draw the line?
Yeah, because that hate speech is, to one person.
And law is meant to be interpreted.
Yeah, but
it is interpreted. So there's no... No.
So do judges make law from the bench, or do they interpret law?
They interpret pretty most of the time. Look at the Supreme Court. All they do is interpret a law. Yeah.
And some would argue that that's not their role. Their role is to make rulings on the law.
No, that's in civil proceedings. In a civil law, not in common law. Common law is to interpret. If you want civil law, if you want to come back and you want to do it, yeah, absolutely. They just tell you what the law is, and then they uphold or they do whatever. They do not interpret.
But I think what Lindsay was saying is that you're, and is very true to the conversation we're having right now, that this line between free speech and hate speech is becoming pretty, like, more and more fine, you know? And there's some people that are pushing that line,
pushing the
envelope. You know, they're pushing it quite a bit, because it's true that words do matter, and there is some speech that can start some fucking pretty bad fires if left unchecked and just kind of, laissez-faire, you know, let people say whatever the fuck they want, then that's how you end up with, you know, people being inspired to do some pretty bad shit.
The thing is, like, this, you're right, it goes on the left and the right, too. Like, the left does horrible stuff, the right does this horrible stuff. But there are laws there that are meant to protect people, which people don't do. Like, people will call, Trump a fascist or whatever. In all honesty, legality, he can go take these people to court.
It's hate speech.
It's not hate speech. It's libel and slander. You can do this stuff. So there are laws to protect people from just random slander and unfounded speech. So to say, like, you can take people to court for stuff, but no one does it because, you know, it's kind of a... Let's be honest, kind of a waste of money, because you're just going to clog up the system and it's a bit ridiculous. But... there are laws to protect people, and on both sides, and depending on what they say, like, speech is not, as much as there is free speech, you cannot just say whatever you want, not just because of hate speech, but also because of slander and liability laws and whatever else. Sorry, libel laws.
Libel.
Liability would completely different. Anyways, but what would be the...
All right, give us your legal, your educated legal opinion, Jason. We need a resident lawyer. That's what we need here.
You know, if you
guess who would be a great resident lawyer here? No. Okay. No. We won't. We have made a pledge to not.
Yes.
Take on that subject on this podcast. It's probably a good idea, right?
Yes.
You don't have to be silent about that because we're being filmed, right?
I agree. It's a good idea. I completely agree. But anyway, but going back to like what you were saying, like so CBC had a great story about like because the Quebec mosque killing and how terrible. He would listen to what in Quebec's called Radio Poubelle. So it's basically people, like it's basically hate speech and these people talking. So they actually aired one of the call-ins and it was a guy calling in and saying, I think Muslims should be indicated when Muslims give blood because I don't want a Muslim's blood in me when I go for a transfusion or something.
Corey, so remind me to come back to this and just cut that part out of Lindsay saying that.
So I'm not saying it.
I can repeat her saying, I don't want Muslim blood. And we'll just randomly click it and play it during
out of context. How racist
like,
she was.
Listen to the podcast. Lindsay Leonard has these great views. I don't want.
I am doing it. I am.
They actually play that like to show that, and like Radio Poubelle is actually a really popular thing in Quebec, where these hosts basically say anything and everything, and they were saying like that's part of like what. Like drove the killer.
Yeah.
Because he'd listen to that stuff.
Yeah, and what we, me and Jay had a little bit of an exchange on Facebook the other day that the public can go out and see. But they were talking about the original poster. I think he put something up about how there was lack of media attention on the whole shooting at the Quebec mosque and like where are the Facebook filters and shit like that for that. And you know what? That was a very good point. Like, where's the outrage and so on? And I think we kind of ended up in this big discussion as to...
Because he was white.
You know. Well, yeah, we know. Like, it's...
Well, the Eiffel Tower changed their colors. You know?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Like, it's... I think when it really comes down to it, though, like, all that shit doesn't really amount or mean anything. Yeah. It shows solidarity for what, all of 3-4 days until you find a cuter picture of your kids to put on your fucking profile picture. And that basically is where it stops. But if we're talking about real concrete solutions and things to move forward with, like I don't know. I thought about the comment that I had put on one of your replies just saying that I think as much as there's a lot of attention at saying, okay, how do we outreach to these people in the Muslim community who are susceptible to being, you know, brainwashed into this extremist ideology and so on. The same shit is happening to these fucking nationalists who are, you know, being brainwashed by this Radio Poubelle and shit like that, where people call in and they express all these fucking toxic views. And it's the outreach needs to go in both ways. We need to realize that there's like terrorism being brewed on all sides here. And like, you know, we can sit here and talk about who started it, or we can go like, all right, guys, let's everybody calm the fuck down and nobody needs to kill each other. We all got a lot of shit, a lot more in common with each other than we do. Yeah. You know.
Well, but the outrage that morning, how when they were like, the guy's name's Muhammad. So Twitter, everything was like, this is what Trump's talk. Trump is right. Yeah. And then all of a sudden.
Oh, no, he's a white dude.
Oh, no.
White kid.
French white kid. Muhammad was actually helping people and he's a witness. Yeah. Everyone just stopped.
Yeah, yeah.
People deleted their Facebook posts and their Twitter posts. Yeah.
Just terrible. that's just a sign of the times, though. Being on like Facebook, just the instantaneous thought finger post, you know, like,
and it's also part of
it's not healthy and helpful.
I think it also is a commentary on news. So people want to, you know, you have Trump talking about how the fake news is talking about this and that, which is ridiculous. Them call it fake news is stupid. These people are journalists and they have integrity. They're trying to do whatever. But there's one issue, and there's a commentary that can be made on news, is that they are now rushing to be first to first to news and
without
first
the facts.
Without the facts or all the facts. So just say something and just, oh, we got these two people. These are the two names. Oh, and then you lead to everyone to assume whatever, and they already made their decisions. What, you know, Some people didn't go back to go check CBC News later and see that, oh, actually, this guy was actually
there was a redaction.
A redaction. Under, it's like, oh, no, they still think it's just crazy.
And they published his name.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Imagine it. Mm-hmm. Imagine Lindsay Deschamps. I got this time. Just killed multiple people.
She does not want Muslim blood given to her.
Well, let's clear this. Let's be quiet for a second. Lindsay Deschamps does not like Muslims.
Let's be clear here.
All right, so let's keep.
Yeah, you guys keep talking about this. Oh,
super.
Redaction.
We always do super professional stuff here. We pee while we're talking because we don't stop.
Just keep the door open.
Okay. No, but I think that's the issue. Is it's news jumping on it? Like they did it with, flight. Is in Indonesia flight? Was that the one that crashed and they never found it?
The Malaysian
flight.
Yeah.
Malaysia, Indonesia, really.
It's pretty close.
All the islands in the South Pacific. It's first to news. Let's talk about this. Let's give any piece of ounce of information we have. And then the other issue is that they bring in all these people to come talk. So, CNN and CBC is like, oh, there was a shooting in Ottawa. All right, let's bring in these two commentators. We don't know anything about this yet. Like, what's your view on Islamic extremists and attacks in Canada? And people start talking like, well, we got to figure out how to do it. We got to bring the imams in to talk to their people to stop them. Meanwhile, nothing to do with that.
Yeah.
And it can be vice versa. It can end up being that, but they're jumping to it right away and they're just talking about that yet. And, and look at all the Canadian... attacks. They've all been Canadian born.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They're all citizens. They've been here forever. They did not come in at any point.
And I find CNN is the worst. I know Trump says fake news, but CNN should be called when you should not be watching the news and you shouldn't hear, I think.
Well, that's
from their reporters.
Well, they have the reporters or they have their panelists. And that's the panelists. And the panelists are essentially opinion pieces. So you look at the paper, there's editorials and opinion pieces. Those are supposed to be taken as editorial or opinion pieces, not supposed to be taken as news.
Right.
So when they have their panelists, that's the same thing. The panelists are editorial or opinion pieces. They are not news. Yeah. So we have to understand we cannot take them as being news.
Okay, but they'll also be like, and you heard it here first, folks.
Yeah, they'll say it.
He might be a serial killer.
And, I think, and we're quick to say, CNN's the first one is the one to do this. But, you look at MSNBC, you look at, Fox News, they all do it, but CNN's the popular one. CNN, and it's not even that the most popular. It might not be the most views, but it's not anymore. It was, but not anymore. It's
their
Fox
own
News
channel, right? It's 24
but
hours
I think,
a day.
But Fox News has their 24 hours a day now. So does MSNBC, all these other places. But the thing is, CNN was, it's still, when you think about 24-hour news, you think CNN because they were the first ones ever doing it. Yeah. And everyone it modeled after CNN. Mm-hmm. And now Fox News.
You know what?
Kills
I think people are tuning into Beer and Bullshit to get their news these
days.
That's what I would do.
Well, dozens of them. Which, and a way to get through Green Bullshit is to subscribe on YouTube, to, sign up and subscribe on iTunes and Google Play, and check out the Facebook page.
I thought we were going to get through one podcast without a shameless plug.
No. Okay. We plug all the time.
Plug it.
Yeah.
No, you're right about the CNN being first and people just kind of quoting or looking at CNN as the model of that 24-hour news network, right? That's looking to be first on everything, and I don't know. It's a shame. I feel like there's so much information out there, but there's also so much inaccurate information out there. So.
Well, the thing that's crazy, I'm seeing this on Facebook now, is in local stuff, people will be just saying that the Timmins Press is, it's just biased news and blah, blah, blah. And it's
propaganda
like,
arm of City Hall.
It's like... No, it's not. And then they'll quote, once again, an opinion piece or an editorial piece, which is not news. Those are exactly what they're called, editorial or opinion pieces. They are the opinion of the editor or opinion of the journalist writing whatever. And it is said that way. And it's not news. It's not a news article. A news article is, this happened, here are the facts, done. And I don't think people really understand that.
I stopped subscribing to Daily Press years ago. I can't read it. That and I don't listen
media.
To local radio. Yeah, I'm actually really out of the loop with anything local.
Oh, really?
Because
you should check out Mr. Daly at 92 Rock. He's great.
Oh, he's awesome. No. We love that guy. Friend
absolutely
of the show.
Amazing.
Well, I've heard him on here. Like, he's great. He's really, awesome. Really funny. But I don't listen to local. Like, I don't listen to local radio or I don't read local news. I find it just angers me.
What do you listen to? You listen to podcasts?
Girl? I do listen to podcasts.
Like, oh, see, this is where people are at now. Yeah.
But you know? I love my new favorite thing is Facebook Live with the National.
Okay. Oh, nice.
I love
okay.
The National now, they do Facebook Live, and it's awesome. Like, you see, like, there's thousands of people, and, like, you can comment as it's happening. That's where
there's
love
a bunch
the
of racist comments happening in that half time.
It's
too.
Actually pretty good.
Yeah. They have somebody moderating that.
They do. They moderate it, and they kind of say, like, keep it clean, and people are pretty good.
People are all right. Like, most people aren't fucking racist or trolls. Most like
well, chances are they're not watching the National.
That's true.
And also trolls though. Like, and this thing is, you know, we see a lot of stuff online, and it's really online. I don't think that's you can't take that as the opinion of the general populace. That is, trolls do a great job, and you know what? Some of them are 12-year-old kids who know it's not funny, but they think it's hilarious. Mm. So just, and if they say it, they know they'll get a response, so they'll just go on and start just talking shit about stuff.
Yeah. Well, I think that the traditional news model is going away.
Yeah.
Like, the way people are getting their information is a lot more through social media, through, and as much as like we laugh about it, like through podcasts, probably not this one, but through some podcasts. Like which podcasts do you listen to? Most of the time.
You know what? Maybe not so much pot. Like, I'll just turn on my CBC radio app.
Okay, yeah.
And I just listen.
Well, see, and all of those CBC radio shows are all available as podcasts as well. Yeah. Like, they're all recorded, right? And you pick them up. Like, I listen a lot to the Joe Rogan Experience. Speaking of which.
I didn't get to it yet.
Okay.
I didn't get to it.
Anyone who is listening to this podcast right now, do me a favor, take out your iPhone, Android device, whatever the fuck you got in your pocket, go and subscribe to the Joe Rogan Experience and find episode 9/11 with Alex Jones. Okay? Ugh. It's 4 hours of pure fucking gold. They're sitting there drinking whiskey, smoking weed, and talking about conspiracy theories, and it'll blow your fucking mind. The meme that they have going around on Facebook right now, where it's a picture of Alex Jones. So, you know Alex Jones? He's the InfoWars guy,
huge conspiracy theorist.
Okay.
Yeah, so he's the 9/11 was an inside job. He's always fucking throwing around papers.
I got FBI papers. See,
Jay does a great impression. So the meme they have going around is him sitting there going, and the first thing that it's a picture of him taking a hit from a joint, and he's the first line says, "Alex, I don't know how much I can say." Joe says, and as Joe, "Try this, Alex." Alex. Pedophile child, interdimensional pedophiles from space. that line comes out multiple times during that podcast. So I'd suggest anybody who's listening to this one, chances are you probably already subscribed to that Joe Rogan Experience, so you're probably enjoying it.
Mark Deschamps would love that because he also thinks 9/11 was a conspiracy. He continuously, he's like, how does it just fall like so straight and from the top?
Yeah,
because a massive plane went through it. All integrity, that building's integrity is gone.
And you have hundreds of tons falling down on each other, pancaking as it goes. It's
very possible.
I always my thing's always, all right, I know many people who work for the government. I have learned, and I worked in the government, and I've learned that government's pretty fucking useless. And the fact that people believe that some people went in and lined up demolition throughout both of these huge motherfucking towers nonstop on every floor, without anyone else noticing. Like, you'd be like,
but it's not Jay. I got the documents here.
Imagine you're at work and you're like, who are these dudes just plastering the side of the wall here all the time? On every floor, the same spot.
Is that C4?
They're all the same. Like, they keep working on the same structural beams all the time. Like, the World Trade Center did not just close at 5 o'clock. People are in there 24/7. And it's like, no one would have thought that. And like, I've seen how government works with stuff. Like, I've been fighting forest fires that were a kilometer away from town to bring it down. Not, you know, as organized as it is, not that organized. And you think that these people worked this thing out perfect and no one found out, and like, no actual person who was doing it said anything.
See, but I think there's this kind of big thing where people have poked holes in the 9/11 commission report, right? And that there's a giant leap between poking holes in that report and then
proving
the fucking government did it, you know, and they killed a whole bunch of their own people. I think the one thing that does it for me that kind of is that giant caveat that if somebody were to come forward and who felt bad about it, you know, like all these years later, like there's nobody's come out and been
that
like,
would have took thousands of people to get
all,
that ready.
They were all at the bottom of
you know,
the tower.
Well, oh, they all got killed, so they all killed themselves.
You know? Actually, guys, okay, great work, guys. We're having a pizza party in the basement. Wait there. No, not 9/11. We're going to do a 9/12. You guys got a day. Just go have a pizza. We'll be there soon. And just, yeah, that's what
the
that's not a plane. That's the music. Just pumping.
That's the bass, guys. Don't worry about it. Yes, it's dusty. We didn't get the clean ladies in. Don't worry about it.
I think the best thing I've ever heard about that, like kind of refuting it, was never ascribe to a conspiracy what can be explained by incompetence.
There you go. Yeah.
And like, yeah, it's very possible that the people at the very highest level of the government, as they are today, may have been incompetent back then as well. Yeah. You know, the people who were in charge of detecting all this stuff and making sure this doesn't happen, they may have been fucking sitting on their fucking hands.
Well, Commander-in-Chief reading a children's book.
Yeah, yeah, hey. Yeah. Like, how does that, like, the most elaborate terrorist attack or the most elaborate inside job just, like peak at the point where George Bush is sitting there reading My Pet Goat? Like,
he stops for a second.
He's not in some bunker.
He continues
like,
reading.
Like they stop. Yeah, he keeps reading.
Yeah, that was pretty crazy. You could tell he was like, oh.
You know what? Kept it cool.
You could see him processing, but I bet you he was a slow processor. They probably knew, okay, we need to tell him now because he'll understand it in 10 minutes.
It'll take a while.
It'll take him a while.
And he's like, wait a sec, did they say? Yeah.
So when they said a plane in the World Trade Center, that's already happened.
Yeah.
What was the words that they, because in Fahrenheit 9/11 there, the Michael Moore movie, what did he say? He's like, what the guy actually said in his ear, said something like, America is under attack.
There you go.
Sounds like. It could be the moment where you make the most badass move of your life and fucking like, tell these kids,
shoulder roll,
I'll be back when I'm done saving the world.
Kick the kids out of your way on the way out.
Yeah. But then you just keep reading with your like goat voice.
Like, ooh.
What should I do?
Shit. Yeah. And like, so this is official. We've officially become a 9/11 conspiracy podcast.
Oh, we are. Yeah. And we're going to keep
Congratulations,
on.
Congratulations, Lindsay.
This is what I wanted to get us to this whole time.
It was her own personal conspiracy. Yeah. Drag us into this bullshit. So we're approaching on the point where we usually kind of wrap these podcasts up. Jay says no. Jay knows what he's got to do now. I got to speak for 5 minutes while he finds something to say. So we're at the hour and 45-minute mark, more or less. We're coming up on 2 hours. Did you have fun tonight?
I did.
Yeah. Thanks, would you encourage guys. Other people to come on this podcast?
I really would. I would love for more women.
Well, do you have any ideas? Well, we don't know many women.
Well, I think there should be maybe a wife and a wife-to-be. That would be a great, I think, exchange that would happen.
They don't want to come on this.
We should sit here, have a date night.
Yes. And like hash up all the really annoying, embarrassing stories that have happened. I think that'd be great.
You know what would be a great podcast? If Paula was in your place and Sophie was in my place. And they sat here just talking shit on us for two hours. I bet you they could. A lot of material.
Yeah. Because Paula could go through all the podcasts, all his one-liners, and come back with them.
Yeah, Jay rehearsed this in front of the mirror about 6 times.
I wonder if she could be as quick as I am with these things.
I don't know. I think she wouldn't. I think Sophie would be great at this. Yeah, yeah, I think so. It.
Hey, if they want to try, they can. I'm more than happy to let
you know
try.
What? We would love to foster a podcast culture here in Timmins that anybody who's interested in getting into podcasting, like, it's super fucking simple. Yeah. You don't really need all this shit going on there. You just need a microphone, a USB interface, you know.
We'll
you
help them out. We'll help them set up. We'll let them learn how. Like I'm saying, you want to have
we're going to start one, the girls. We're going to call it Boobs and Bullshit.
Sweet.
There you
and
go.
I think we could really, because, you know, they say like girls, like they tend to have great conversations when guys aren't around.
I heard that. I did hear that.
Could be pretty good.
I want to say horrible one-liners. I'm just saying, I have nothing right now, but like I wish I had stuff, but I wouldn't say it if I did. Just, I'm not stupid.
You're right. You know better. So we want to thank you so much for coming on. We really appreciate you coming to spend some time drinking some beer with us and talking a lot about the project that you've got going on the James Bay Coast. This is it's really amazing stuff. I mean, mm-hmm. I feel like we almost didn't we spent a fair amount of time on it, and we kind of really got to know a little bit about it. But is there anywhere that people can learn more about this online, or any way that they can reach out as far as donations go if they want to?
Yeah, I mean, they could always, like, contact me through Facebook.
Okay.
And, yeah, like, we've actually, like, I'm going to do a quick plug to all of our, like, fantastic sponsors.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
So,
yeah.
Like, the Rotary Club from Timmins.
Oh, not those guys. They're on our blacklist. Just kidding.
They donated all the hoodies for all the kids so they can all match when they come to Mishkegwick.
Nice.
We have a few doctors in town, which their names are escaping me. So thank you, doctors.
Association of Random Doctors.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, like, and I'm trying to, like, Kentucky. Every time we go up, Kentucky gives us like 200 pieces of chicken for the kids.
Oh, it's not the state, the KFC.
KFC.
Okay, KFC, sorry. Kentucky, oh, nice. Kentucky Fried Chicken. Yeah, so we have like a few sponsors kind of like sprinkled through town that like they've been fantastic.
Nice, yeah. Nice. So people can get in touch with you through Facebook.
Yeah.
And if they want to donate some time, volunteer, or if they want to get involved in any other capacity, they just need to look you up on Facebook, Lindsay yep. Deschamps. Right? Yep. Brand new Lindsay Deschamps.
Yeah, yeah.
Newly minted.
Newly minted. All right, on that note, we're going to sign off. And Jason, I'm assuming you've gotten enough time to find us a good beer drinking quote for tonight.
I had one forever. Jeez, right. I don't know what you're talking about.
Right. What do you got for us?
A woman drove me to drink, and I didn't even have the decency to thank her.
That's good. I like that one. Cheers. All right. See you guys next week.